You launched this test today. Talk to us about the first day of sales and the reaction so far.
Hi, Emily. It's great to see you again. So we went live today on detect.com, which is our e-commerce shop on the web, selling the Detect COVID-19 test, which is the most affordable PCR quality test in the market today. We're selling it for $49. It gives you essentially the equivalent of a PCR lab test in 1 hour at home. And we've just started selling today. It's going extremely well. We do have quite a bit of inventory, so we don't expect to sell out or anything like that. It's coming, we think, at a time of pretty urgent need. You just highlighted it in your opening remarks here. We've hit this incredibly sad mark of 800,000 deaths in the US alone, heading into a potentially really scary mark of 1 million deaths. And sadly, I think we may be headed into a bit of a perfect storm in this holiday season with obviously the Omicron variant approaching. Dr. Fauci said this week, the likelihood of breakthrough infections is three times higher with Omicron than it was with the Delta variant. Obviously, right. People are going to be traveling. So we are concerned and trying to participate in providing solutions to people in this pandemic. So, folks can gather and travel with a bit more peace of mind.
Now, a lot of companies, schools, events, airports, they want a PCR test result. You say this is PCR quality, but is it a PCR test or doesn't that have to be done in a lab?
It's a molecular test, and most, not all, of the countries that require a test for inbound travel require a molecular test. So for example, Canada, the UK, most European countries, they require a molecular test. And we are a molecular test, which is PCR-like in its quality. What we're doing, just to explain what a molecular test is we look for the genetic material of the virus in that sample, and we amplify that many, many, many times, so we can detect its presence much earlier than you would with what is called an antigen test, right? Which are sort of the more commonly known rapid tests on the market. But with a PCR quality test like ours, we're at least 50% more sensitive than sort of the even highest quality antigen tests in the market. So we can detect the virus much earlier, which is why airlines and some of these markets that require testing when traveling inbound are saying we need a molecular test, of which PCR is one type, and okay. We are another type that offers the same level of sensitivity or accuracy.
Now, you've had high-level jobs at Facebook, Google, Xiaomi, almost always exclusively focused on mobile and mobile phones, and you say you want at-home testing to be as accessible as smartphones. Why use that comparison?
We use that comparison. First of all, it's what I truly believe in. I think the next sort of major wave in sort of consumer innovation is going to point us to healthcare. I would have probably said the same with medium level of confidence 2-3 years ago if you asked me, because I've been studying the healthcare segment for a while. But what happened in this pandemic was just a dramatic acceleration towards basically everything that we were going to do already, right? We've seen telehealth taking off tremendously, right? Regulatory approval for telehealth treatments, telehealth consultations has now happened pretty much all over the world. We have made tremendous progress in prescription and delivery of drugs and therapies and so on and so forth. But what we haven't really done yet is sort of that thing in the middle where you just need an answer. You need to understand what's happening inside of your body before, your provider can help you make a decision on treatment. And that is precisely the gap that we're trying to focus on in here is, can we help dramatically accelerate what is known as diagnostics in the world right. today? And we're starting with infectious disease detection, which is a critical area where there's such a tremendous information gap, as we've seen with this pandemic, right? The lack of information solutions. You simply want to know, do I have this virus or not? Am I at risk of transmitting it to a loved one or not? So this information gap is what we think that the diagnostics world really needs to address. And that's what we're focusing our attention on.
Well, speaking of information, you led Oculus's VR division. I'm sure you've been following Facebook's pivot to the metaverse. My colleagues just reported on the first instance, they believe, of vaccine misinformation making it to the metaverse at a virtual conference in Lisbon. Do you think information is going to be even harder to police in a virtual world, in the metaverse, than it is on social media?
So I read about this incident, Emily, but I didn't watch it, so I don't know specifics about it. But I think I might have a bit of a different point of view as it relates to metaverse. And I think the technology industry should probably take a big step back. First of all, and even how we talk about metaverse, you know, we talk about metaverse as being this sort of dark future in 10 or 20 years where, you know, somehow people are going to be, you know, stuck in their homes, perhaps with a VR headset on in some simulated virtual world where they spend hours and hours in sort of this kind of game-like environment. And while this may happen, you know, in 10 or 20 years for a small sort of segment of the population, essentially kind of the gamer types, what most of people are going to experience that they're going to call metaverse is actually something I think completely different. It's the idea of, you know, overlaying virtual things onto your physical world, right? The fact that you're going to be able to walk around the world and see an augmented, you know, enriched world and be able to communicate or socialize or, you know, entertain, have fun, because you have sort of virtual objects and virtual presence, you know, with you. Of course, you're wearing augmented reality glasses. That is a much more positive outlook for the future. That, to me, is a more promising vision for the metaverse. So I would reframe it to begin with. Of course, when we do get there, there will be problems that we have to solve. And there will be new privacy, you know, frameworks that we're going to have to adopt. I think the important thing to understand is this is 10 or 20 years away, right? So we have time, we have awareness, meaning we know that this stuff could be a problem. So let's get to work on it. But let's do it with a positive outlook for the future. Not, I think, this kind of darker vision that somehow we ended up painting over the last few months.